You're his favorite too. Okay. So if we're equally all his favorite, then we can't get mad, you know? But sometimes we get stuck in, you know, God, I only have $5, but I want a miracle. How $5 ain't going to pay for my miracle. It's not. Guess what? It's not going to pay for your miracle because your faith and your trust isn't in God when you're giving it. You need, whether it's a quarter, whether it's time, if you don't have money to give, go out there and go pray for somebody that needs it. That to God is so much more than you just being, hey, I gave my $5. I gave my tithe. I'm done. You're not done. You need to make sure. Stop looking this way. Stop looking at this way and look here. And look here. Okay? So, so let's give. Okay. All right. So if you're watching online, you're going to go, text emic.org/give. Text to give, text the number 36609. The keywords are EMIC, then put the dollar amount in $500. Just kidding. Amor. And then example is EMIC 25. Okay. And, if you need an envelope or an envelope, they should be on your desk. Some of the ushers, if you need one, raise your hand. They'll come around and make sure that you give that. So, when you give today, don't worry about what your neighbor is giving. Worry about the trust and the faith that you're putting, even if it's 2 cents, because that's what counts. It's what you're trusting him for. 2 cents can get you that airplane. Okay. All right. So let's pray. Father God, I just thank you right now for this offering. I pray that you would set a fire in the hearts of your people, Father, as they pray, that they would not go, that they would not belittle themselves, or that they would learn how to appreciate their time with you, that you do, that what they do does not go unseen, that you cherish every moment and everything that they give, whether it's money or time or kindness, and that you would just renew in them, Lord, give them a new revelation of your love. Of your love for them, and that they would know that when they give to you, they're not giving anything to you because you already have it all. What they're giving you is their trust and their faith. And I thank you that they're going to have a huge harvest on their way. And I just pray that you supernaturally just bless them all, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you. Amen.
Amen. And thank you, Alex. God loves a cheerful giver, a giver that'll give in faith. Amen. Not in comparison to what someone else gives. And what I would like for Alex to give, I'd like for her to give a line of vitamins where you could take them and be as excitable as her and as energetic as her. That's what I'd like for her to give. Amen. Do you appreciate her? Praise God. I just have just a, yes, right. Give her a hand. Amen. I have just a few announcements to share with you while we are receiving tonight's tithes and offering, and like to remind you, as always, that Healing School and Ministry happens somewhere here every day of the week, and we have a paper calendar that you can find out more about that from in our lobby if you're here tonight. If not, you can always go online, go to emic.org, Believers Institute, and you can download that calendar, and that way you can avail yourselves to the healing ministry here, or can let someone else know about the healing ministry. Amen? Also, I'd like to remind you that our Faith Foundations, that's every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock Central Standard Time right here in this room. If you can be here, be here. And this being Resurrection Sunday, it's going to really be good, and it's going to really be a surprise. Would you like to know what it's going to be? I can't tell you. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a surprise. But it's going to be good, so you won't want to miss it. All right, that's 9 o'clock this Sunday morning right here. Also, those of you here, you should have a copy of tonight's outline. If you don't have that copy, you can raise your hands. One of our ushers or assistants will be glad to make sure that you get a copy of tonight's outline. And I do see a few hands over here. If we can make sure that they get tonight's outline. Those of you who are watching or listening, if you can go to emic.org, you can click on the rotator, and that'll take you to a page where you can pull up tonight's outline, and that way you can follow along with us in the book, The Blessing and the Lesson for Tonight, which is the blessings in reality, right? Reality, reality, the blessing in reality. He kind of messed with my title a little bit there. I'm going to talk to him about that. Come on, let's receive Pastor Greg as he comes.
Thanks, Doc. I'm good. Hallelujah. Dr. T is one of the most anointed people here. And if you, and just ask him, he'll tell you. I'm teasing. Couple of things I need to bring to your attention is, first of all, the 9 a.m. class in here this Sunday will not be in here this Sunday. We have a very special thing because of the special programming that we have. Pastor Jeremy Pearson will be speaking to you online and on television all around the world, and we're going to get ready for a very special service in here. So there's not a live 9 a.m. In here. Was that your surprise? I was instructed. Can you help me out, boss? The boss instructed me, make that clear. And so there's not a live thing in here, and whoever I said was speaking. We have many, for you in the local church here, we have many small groups that are meeting and new ones that have formed. The Eagle Mountain Riders motorcycle went off this last Sunday, and many people had fun with that. But the Israel Club has a table set up out in the lobby immediately after service, if you want to look, at a Passover table. If it's never been to a Passover Seder, okay, you can look at it, see what it's all about, and they're going to be having, you pick one of these up, they're going to be having a Passover Seder here at the church that you might want to be, you might be interested in and going to and seeing that, and just make yourself available that they can answer any question that you have concerning that. Okay, if you were expecting Pastor George tonight, I'm sorry, it's me. And but it's always an honor and a privilege to open the Word of God, to minister it to you, and we are talking about the blessing. Are you ready? Here we go. Father, we thank you and we praise you and we honor you and we magnify you. We lift you up. May all men be brought down so that you can be lifted up. And we give you praise and glory and honor forever and ever and ever. Wash us in your word. Reveal yourself to us tonight in a way that maybe we have not seen before, but we will never be the same. We'll be changed from glory to glory to glory. Give me clarity of thought and purpose. In Jesus' mighty name, touch physical bodies in this place. Give us clarity of thought in our mind. All the stuff, yeah, thank you, Holy Spirit. All the things that we've carried with us today and all week long, we just shake those things off right now and we set at your feet for you to instruct us and touch us. Quicken physical bodies, mortal bodies right now by the power of the Holy Ghost. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and agree. And everybody says, amen. Amen and amen. All right, I'm going to hit this subject, and then I'll be hitting this subject in the month of May for those of you in here and on television. And we're talking about the blessing. I love to define things, right? The blessing defined, Merriam-Webster says, it's God's favor and protection, the act or words of one that blesses, approval, encouragement conducive to happiness or welfare. You liking it so far? I am. Brother Copeland, in his book, The Blessing, said it this way. It's the very creative force of God to empower you. Oh, I like that too. I love that. Don't you? Mankind began in the blessing. The very first thing that mankind heard was the blessing of God. And in Judaism, always, where do you get all that stuff you teach? Well, I have a whole bunch of books, and here's one of the old ones right here. This is a book. Our Jewish brothers grabbed hold of this blessing thing. Every Shabbat, every Sabbath, they bless their children. They speak of it. Isn't that right? They bless their children. The blessing is an important thing in their life, and this book is a book of to pray as a Jew. And they said, you really read this stuff? I really read this stuff. I am a Bible nerd. Amen. I mean, I do. I just dig stuff out. And so they have understood this blessing thing. And I'm going to be honest with you, as believers, as Christians, we've kind of lost some of that. But thank God it's coming back. Amen. Amen. And that we're getting a hold of this, our true heritage and where we are. And that's where Abraham. Because that's where we're tied into bringing this thing from a spiritual concept into the reality in the material world. All right? So, mankind began in the blessing. You are, in Hebraic thought, you are expected to bless God before you ever ask Him for anything. You bless Him. There's a blessing for the first thing in the morning. When you first wake up, there is a blessing that every observant Jewish man and woman recite, and they say, Baruch atah Adonai Melechenu Olam. What's he doing? I'm not speaking in tongues. That's Hebrew. All right. How do you know? Well, somebody said, show off. What's your last name?
Abrams.
His last name's Abrams. Cheater. But the very first thing that you say, now listen, I want to read you the very first blessing you say in the morning. You have it in your handout. If you want the notes, you can download the notes online. I encourage you to do so. Blessed art thou, this is what I said in Hebrew. Blessed art thou, O Lord God, King of the universe. Listen to this. Who has given the rooster the intelligence to distinguish day and night. Job 38. It's from Job 38, the Hebrew word shekvi, which means rooster, or other translations will say from the heart. All right, but it's the rooster. Who's given the rooster the intelligence to distinguish between day and night, who opens the eyes of the blind. This sounds familiar. Who releases the bound, who raises up those who are bowed down, who sets forth the earth upon the waters. Look at this. Who directs the steps of a man, who provided for my every need, who girds Israel with might, who crowns Israel with glory, who gives strength to the weary, who removes sleep from my eyes and slumber from my eyelids. Blessed art thou, O Lord, who bestows great kindness upon his people. That blessing, now think about all of those things. Go back to the first one, if you don't mind. Can you go back one? This is the procession of how you get up in the morning. The rooster, the alarm clock, wakes me up, right? Who opens the eyes of the blind. I was blinded because I was asleep, oblivious to anything and going on around me in the room. Who releases the bound. I'm wrapped up in covers. If you're in my house, I have no covers. They're all somewhere else. So that one doesn't apply to me, but who raises, pray, reach hands out toward, who raises up those who are bowed down. We're bowed down. We're lying down. All of this morning, and there's a scripture. Morning. Now, there's a very interesting phrase as I was reading over this that stood out to me for the time of year that we're in. What time of year are we in right now? Pesach. Week. It's referred to as, come on, help me, Holy Week. So things happen. This is the last week of Jesus' life, right? Now think about, we just think about something that Jesus said. Peter would have known this blessing. And the Lord said to him, before the what crows? Now think about this for a second. Are you happy? Are you happy? Think about this. He is at, when this happens, he's at Caiaphas's house. I've been there. And there's a pit. And they had lowered Jesus into this pit. And he's in the pit and Peter is in the courtyard. and the rooster crows. He has denied him. Jesus is basically saying, before morning prayers, you will have denied me. Now think about all of these religious Frankensteins, Pharisees, I mean, all of these Pharisees that are standing there, and the rooster crows, and what did they begin to do? They began to pray. And what did they begin to pray? Baruch atah Adonai Mel. What? Blessed art thou, Lord God, King of the universe, who has given the rooster. And Peter went, I just realized what I've done. See, that whole rooster thing now with Jesus wasn't just a colorful phrase he said to him. He said, before you guys have morning prayers. And when that rooster crowed, Peter right then realized, I did it. We don't see him again now for a while after that. He's not at the crucifixion site. The conviction hits him right there. Isn't that cool? But now think about Peter for a minute. He's been an eyewitness to so much that's happened in this week. When are you going to talk about the blessing? I'm getting there. That is the blessing for the morning. So much that he's seen this week. Think about that. He's seen the triumphant entry of Jesus into the temple area, right? He saw the what did Adam, where are you? It's not really what he said in the Hebrew. He knew where they were. When my mother called me, where are you? She knew where I was and that I'm the one that broke something. Right? They were. He's God. But if you read the Hebrew, that's not what he said. He didn't say, where are you? In Hebrew, it says, why are you where you are? Why are you there? Why are you unclothed? Why are you losing your glory? Why are you in that place that you're in? That's a whole different phrase, isn't it? And he says, we were afraid because we're naked. Who told you that? And they had sewn fig leaves together to hide them, to cover themselves. Remember this? Was that right? And the Lord went later and he got animal skins. That's why it's okay to have a leather jacket. I'm just saying. Don't get mad at me. And maybe it's okay to have a fur coat. Right, baby? Fur coat. The tree of life is there, and we don't hear about the tree of life again until the book of Revelation. The tree of life has leaves and fruit, and we'll eat of that. The leaves for the healing of the nations and the fruit. Remember this? We have a fig tree that has leaves but no fruit. Now we have people that have sown fig leaves on themselves to cover themselves, to cover what? To cover their sin. Jesus, this happened in the last week of his life. When he cursed the fig tree, he's making a statement. There's not going to be any more covering of sin. I'm going to eradicate this thing. I'm done with this thing. No more covering. Praise God, that's a shout moment right there. There's no more covering of sin. It's been dealt with once and for all. I'm about to get happy. That's part of the blessing, isn't it? Isn't that cool? PG, Pastor George, that's what we call it, PG. We have Pastor George and Pastor Gene, he's PG2. I'm Pastor Greg, I'm PG3. Or PG cube, as the younger people in our office called it, because three is cubed, so I'm Cubert. So he talked about the triumphal entry into Jerusalem where they're saying, Hoshianu, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. See, that part of what they were doing is not unusual. That happens every year, but it happens at Tabernacles. I told you when we did that service and we talked about the processions that come and the water and all that. Remember that? How many of you were here on that Wednesday? That's Tabernacles, but it's happening at Passover. That's why the Pharisees are in sin. Wait, no, we're not about that. We're about Passover. We're about the sheep gate, that whole thing. This is not what we do now. This is what we do at Tabernacles. And you're doing it at Passover. This is wrong. But I'm going to tell you something. Let me show you something, make you happy. This very day was foretold nearly three centuries earlier. I'm talking still about the blessing. Want me to show you? You okay? I'm talking about the blessing playing out in the natural world. The book of Daniel was translated into Greek prior to 270 BC. We know that is a well-established fact in secular history. You guys doing okay tonight? You all right? Okay, here we go. Alexander the Great conquered the world, right? Promoted a common language throughout the known world that everyone should understand and speak Greek. That was an important thing for the gospel to go around the world. It was a very important thing for Alexander the Great to do what he did, because now the gospel can be written into one language and go around the world. Jesus would have been able to understand and speak Greek. Yes, because how do I know that? Because the Greeks came to him to talk to him. Hebrew was kind of had become a religious language in his time. People still spoke it, but if you'll realize, Jesus most of the time spoke Aramaic, which is a little bit different. It's close. It's very close. It's not Arabic, but it's very, very close. And they still read the scripture out of Hebrew, but they could have read the scripture out of Greek, the Greek Septuagint. All right? So, interesting enough, on a side note of that, if you go over to Revelation and you begin to look at the book of Revelation, you'll find out that one of the beasts and one of the creatures has all these different things on it, and it has the mouth of a lion. You ever wondered about that? The mouth of the lion is the symbol of Britain. It's the mouth of English. Once again, we have a world that English is predominantly the language of business, predominantly, come on. Just like it was in the earlier day when it was Greek, now it's English. I can go to most nations and find somebody that speaks English. Kind of a little sign of the time, my friend. Okay, let me get back to history, sorry. Back to history. Ptolemy the Second Philadelphus, that's the dude's name, began translating what we know as the Greek Septuagint Bible in 285 to 246 BC. He had 70 scholars working with him, translating the Hebrew text to Greek. We sometimes see it when you do study, you'll see XX70, and that's referring to the 70 scribes that were working on it. The book of Daniel existed 3 centuries before Jesus in written form. And Daniel, in Daniel chapter 9, I'm reading out of the MEV, Modern English Version. So it may be a little different, but it's very close to the King James, just a little modernized. Is that okay? He's reading from the book of Jeremiah and realizes that the 70 years of slavery are almost over. And he begins to pray. And when he does, Gabriel, the angel, comes to him. Let me start. I know they're starting with you're starting with verse 21. Verse 21. I was even yet speaking in prayer, and that man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, flying swiftly, touched me about the time of evening sacrifice. And he caused me to understand and spoke with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to cause thee to understand the interpretation. At the beginning of thy supplications, at the beginning of your prayers, the word went forth, and I have come to teach it unto you, unto thee. For thou art a man greatly beloved, therefore understand the word and understand the vision. And then he begins to talk about things. You guys are familiar. You're used to the term Daniel's 70 weeks, right? Yes? You need to understand there's a time lag between the 69th and the 70th week. Prophetically, we're living in that. That's us. That's part of the mystery that Paul talks about. All right, where'd I stop? 24? 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city. I underlined it. There's a reason. To finish the provocation and to conclude the sin and make reconciliation for the iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and seal the vision and the prophecy and to anoint the Holy of Holies. Know, therefore, and understand that from the going forth of the word to cause the people to return and to build Jerusalem unto the anointed prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, while the street shall be built again and the wall even in troublous times. Okay? If you understand the Shemitah years, you guys have heard this taught. Seven, sevens, and all that, right? I'm not going to jump off. I got to stay focused. So if you understand that a week of years, you understand that that phrase is the Sabbath for the land. Okay? Notice verse 24, it said, upon the people and the city. That's a concentration upon the people and the city. We're talking about Israel and we're talking about Jerusalem. This prophecy is not directed to the church. Okay, it was really too quiet there. It scared me for just a minute. This is not directed to the church. This prophecy is concerning the nation of Israel and the city of Jerusalem. And it's in there for a reason, specific. Verse 25 has a very specific prediction. You have a mathematical element now entered into this thing. All right? Remembering there's a gap between the 69th week and the 70th week. Jewish and Babylonian calendars are both 360 days in a year. Okay? So 69 weeks of 360 years totals 173,880 days. You're going to be amazed in a moment at the accuracy of God's word. You know, I've had people say before, I literally had somebody say this when I've taught this before. Well, I wish Gabriel would come down and touch me, or some angel would come and explain things to me. Honey, I love you, but that's not going to happen. Do you know why? Because of the time that you live in. If you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit in you now to reveal what the prophecy, and the Pastor Terry's been teaching it to us, you can know what you just prayed out in the Spirit. You can ask for the interpretation of it. I'm a little leery of any religion or anything that an angel has come down and given them a new anything. Because we now have the Holy Ghost. I'd rather have the Holy Ghost in me revealing things than an angel. Don't write letters to Brother Copeland. This is strictly, you can send them right to me. And I'm not bashing anyone or anything. All right? So if you understand these phrases, you begin to understand this stuff, you get it. The anointed one, prince, or Messiah prince, in Hebrew, is the Mashiach Nagid. What does that mean? Messiah king. This is literally talking about the Messiah king. And when he's going to be revealed, and things that are going to be associated to that revealing. Now, here's where it gets fun. You ready? The command to rebuild Jerusalem was given by Artaxerxes on March 14th, 445 BC. How do we know that? Secular history tells us that. All right? Now, that verse refers to the street and the wall. Note, you remember it saying that? The street and the wall in Artaxerxes' thing. To avoid any confusion of what this is saying. The rebuilding of the wall was a totally different time than what Daniel's seeing right now from Gabriel. Rebuilding of the wall is Nehemiah. We're talking about something else now. So during the time of Jesus, there were many times that the people tried to promote him as the Messiah king. And he always avoided that. He would always say, "My hour has not come." Remember that? Then one day, he gives instructions to the disciples to go get him a ride. Remember this? So that he can go into Jerusalem. That fulfills the prophecy of Zechariah 9:9. You need to understand something, that the things that Jesus did, he did everything to fulfill this, to the letter. There's one place that he wasn't called to go to pray for anybody or heal anybody. He purposely went to this place to heal somebody because Elisha had gone to that place to heal somebody. He's fulfilling. I told you, I study Jesus and everything that he does. I am one of his disciples. Okay, you don't have to get happy about it, but I am. I've determined if he were here and I was back there, I would have been one of the guys because I want to know everything I can. Because I'm supposed to be like him, as he is. Rejoicing about this triumphal entry, we might have missed this whole thing had the Pharisees not brought it to our attention. The crowd to be Messiah king. And the Pharisees said, make them stop this. Remember that? Say, my time has not come. He endorsed it. In Luke 19:40, any stones near there? Yeah. That's all it is. All right? This is the moment that he will present at his destruction. And we know at John's birth, an announcement birth, what course of priests were in the temple. So we can pretty much pinpoint. We can get pretty close to it, very close to it. We know that he was. It is exactly from the time Daniel heard that from Gabriel. It is 445 B.C. to April 6th, 32 A.D. is exactly 173,880 days to the day. It's exactly why he told them, go get that colt, because today's the day. He knew what Gabriel had told Daniel. This should all have been known to everybody. They were expected to know that passage of Daniel. Just like Gabriel said. He said, Messiah will be cut off, not for himself, or in other words, some versions say, having nothing. Then the city and the sanctuary will be destroyed. That's going to happen 38 years later when the Romans destroy the temple under Titus. Why is this happening? Jesus tells us in Luke 19, Luke 19, verse 43 and 44, for the days will come upon you when your enemies... Now, understand what Jesus is doing when he says this. This is on his way in on that colt when he teaches this right here. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you and surround you and press in on every side. They will dash you and your children with you, within you to the ground. They will not leave one stone upon another within you because, look at this, I underlined it for emphasis, because you did not know the time of your visitation. You should have known by Daniel's prophecies. Because you did not know the time of your visitation. I'm going to ask you a question. Have you and I missed the time of our visitation? Because we live in the last days. How do I know it's the last days? Acts chapter 2, Peter gets up and says, this is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel in the last days. You're in the last days. The last days started right then. It's also known as the church age, dispensation of the church, right? What else is it known as? Somebody? Anybody know? The church age, the last days, what else is it known as? The time frame that we live in. Thank you. I heard it somewhere. Grace. The age of grace. Have we missed our day of visitation? We live in the age of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to be so bold as to say, if you're not hooked up with the ministry of the Holy Spirit, that's our day of visitation. Jesus is not physically here. The Holy Spirit is. That's my day of visitation, the Holy Spirit. It's the time I live. When God ushered in a new covenant of grace, he sent his beloved son, Jesus. He didn't send a new rules or commandments to us. He didn't set a whole bunch of new commandments to us. He sent Jesus. So grace is a person, not a doctrine. You can see that in John chapter 1, verse 14 and John chapter 1, verse 17. He's a person. He is grace and truth. Every blessing that we would ever need is inseparable from the person of Jesus. Christianity, my friend, is not a formula. This is why it's not a religion. True Christianity. It's not a formula. God so loved the world that he gave us a person, not a handbook. I mean, we had the word, you understand? But the word became flesh. That's why you got to get in love with the word. So now, let me get back to the thing here, right? Let's get back to this. But first, let me say this to you. The Lord being with you is all you need in this life. Because the Lord himself is the one who blesses you with righteousness and holiness, success, victory, favor, provision, healing, wisdom, much more. More than you could think or ask. So how do I access this blessing? Galatians 3. Galatians 3. I'm done with the history lessons. We'll go on now. You can wake your neighbors up that don't like history. Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. I love the way this is written. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? That's strong. That you should not obey the truth. Who's the truth? Jesus. Who's the spirit of truth? Your day of visitation, isn't it? in Hebrew, and I taught this my very first time here, the Aleph and the Tav, the first and the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet. It's translated, it's written in the scripture many times and not translated. In Hebrew, it's referred to as Et. Okay? I call it Jesus' autograph. It's all throughout the scripture, thousands of times. And it's where he autographed the Bible. This is me. This is me. That's me. You ever done a memo and you autograph, you initial by different points? That's exactly what he did. The word for truth has the middle letter of the Hebrew alphabet, Aleph Tav, with Mem. Emet, truth. He is the front end and the back end of all truth and the right in the middle of this thing. All right, let me go on. Sorry, I told you no more history and I just did that. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? Before your eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed among you as among you crucified. I want you to learn only from this. Did you receive the Spirit through the works of the law or by hearing of faith? Are you so foolish? Man, listen to Paul. Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now perfected by the flesh? Have you endured so many things for nothing, if indeed it was for nothing? Does God give you the Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Somebody answer me. What? Thank you. Even Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Therefore, know that those who are of the faith are the sons of Abraham. I'm a son. And the scripture, look at this, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles, how?
By faith.
Preach the gospel in advance to Abraham, saying, in you all the nations shall be blessed. So then those who are of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. Those of you who are in faith are blessed. You want the blessing?
Yes.
How does it happen?
By faith.
In what covenant?
Abraham.
Not Moses' covenant. Abraham's covenant. There it is. We're blessed by what Jesus accomplished on the cross. Before your eyes, Jesus was clearly portrayed. That's why I dig into history and word meaning, so I can portray him accurately. Anybody learn anything tonight on those just things I showed? Even that rooster thing. That's what I pray every time. Lord, reveal yourself to me today. Let me see something about it. Show me somewhere where you're at so I can just go, whoa, because that's what happens in heaven. The seraphim fly around the throne and they're just like, holy, holy, holy. Whoa, they see something they've never seen before. That's going to go on through all eternity. And you and I will be part of it. The elders fall on their face. There's many facets to him. And I love it. I can't wait. That's why we dig into these things. All of this blessing is yours. When did you get it? When? When you were born again. That's when you got it. Well, I don't feel like it. Didn't say that. I didn't ask you that. I said, when did you get the blessing? The moment you were born again, the moment you believed, like Abraham believed. I used to ask students in class all the time when I taught in Bible school, were people in the first covenant, the first testament, the first book, were they saved? How many of you think they were? How many of you think they weren't? Come on, be honest. Just don't be afraid. How many think people in the First Testament were not saved? The Old Testament weren't saved. They were, because Abraham lived in that time. So how were they saved? By faith. You guys, it's not fair. It's just not a level playing ground at this church. You're too smart. Most will say, well, they were saved by keeping the law. No, the scripture plainly tells us that nobody's justified by the law. Well, they were done by sacrifices. No, the blood of bulls and goats cannot. They were saved the same way you were saved the same way Abraham was saved. He believed God and it was counted unto him as righteousness. That's the way you were saved. This is why you're in that covenant, based upon what Jesus did. Man, I'm about to get happy. The faith of Abraham is what unlocked the blessing. It's through the Spirit by faith that unlocks the door. I right now, you right now, how many born again people in here? Let me help you with something. Right now, you are a co-possessor of all things in heaven and earth. Remember what the high priest said to Abraham? Blessed Abraham. Possessor of what? Heaven and earth. Remember that? That's you. That's the title over you because you're in that lineage. Shh, dear God. That's the blessing in your life. Bless Greg, possessor of heaven and earth. And that I access that not based upon anything Greg did. I access that based upon what Jesus did, putting me in that. Praise God. So you want to know what God's will is for your life? Anybody want to know? Yeah? I'm going to give it to you. It's to live in the blessing. Everything else will work out from there. To live in the blessing is God's will for your life. Ooh, I'm going to say that again. I love that. To live in the blessing is God's will for my life. Say that with me. To live in the blessing is God's will for my life. Woo, glory to God. Woo. Well, how do I do that? You do it by faith. You can never work your way into this or earn this. Let me tell you how Abraham lived. That's what I'm doing. I'm telling you how Abraham lived. So you're saying then I don't have to do what's right. No, I did not say that. If I'm doing what's right to earn the blessing, then I'm wrong. I do what's right because it's right. Yes. Abraham, our father, according to the flesh. Now, we're not. You are. I'm not. Come on now. A seed of Abraham according to the flesh. You are. I'm not. I'm a seed of Abraham according to the Spirit. There you go. Attached to the flesh of Jesus. Okay? Our Father, according to the flesh, has found. If Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast of. Whenever God... Yes? So if God said, you're righteous, can anyone undo that? Now, some of you are tilted. There were a couple of people that got tilted. Just hit their reset button. Reset them real quick. I can't undo that. He would have to undo that. Now, I'm not acting righteously. That's why the Holy Spirit will convict me of all unrighteousness. Say, dude, what you did on the 287 is not righteous. I said the 287, didn't I, again? I haven't gotten rid of that. I haven't gotten rid of that California thing yet. Verse 4. Now to him who works, wages are not given as a gift, but as a debt. But to him who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness. Look at verse number 13. Romans 4:13. It was not through the law that Abraham and his descendants received the promise that he would be their heir of the world, but through the righteousness of faith. There it is again. For if those who are of the law become heirs, faith would be made void and the promise nullified. Verse 16. Therefore, the promise comes through faith so that it might be by grace. And the promise would be certain to all the descendants, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As is written, I have made you the father of many nations before God, whom he believed, and who raises the dead and calls those things that do not exist as though they did. You cannot keep the commandments of God apart from faith. You will fail every time. That's why religion doesn't work. When is it ever enough? Have you ever met a religious person? Okay, I grew up in that church. I'm going to read my Bible for an hour every day and then pray in tongues for an hour. And then by Wednesday or Thursday, I didn't do it. And then something happens and you're like, the enemy will come to you or some blessed religious saint will come to you and say, you didn't keep your vow to God. And that's why that, when is it ever enough? And then you're thinking, if I want to be at Brother Copeland's level, I need to read the Bible 3 hours a day. And then it's 3.5 hours a day. And then it's never enough. It's the hamster wheel that never stops. To the religious, it's never enough. To the legalist, it's never enough. That's why religion doesn't work. One of the guiding principles of this ministry that I love so much is this: to take believers from the milk to the meat, from religion to reality.
Amen.
I love that phrase. To take believers from the milk to the meat, from religion to reality. That's one of the guiding principles of Kenneth Copeland Ministries and Eagle Mountain Church. True Christianity is not a religion. It is God and His family that are the body of people saved by grace through faith, made righteous and blessed by faith. Through faith, the worlds were framed by the Word of God. Is that right? Somebody said to me one time, "You're one of them faith preachers." Well, duh. I can't. What are you? You can't get saved apart from faith. The entire physical universe was made by faith. The cotton in your t-shirt, hot rod, was made by faith and into existence, and it made your shirt. So if you don't like faith movement, why are you buying cotton shirts? You can't have a wooden house. Because God spoke all those things by faith. So you're a faith guy too. And when I said that to this one reverend, he just looked at me. I could literally see the vein begin just. And I wasn't trying to be disrespectful or angry. I'm just trying to. John chapter 1. I had a guy tell me one time, he goes, "I don't go to church because I don't like hypocrites." I go, "You will not like hell." John chapter 1, verse 1. Oh, there's a bunch of them down there. Just saying. I'm running out of time. I may not finish this tonight, but I'm back next week. Verse 1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Created through Him, and without Him, nothing was created that was created. In Him was life, and the life was the light of mankind. The light shines in darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it." Verse 14, look at John 1:14. I quoted this a while ago. "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw His glory. The glory as the only Son of the Father." Look at this. Full of what? It's a person, not a doctrine. Don't be mad at the grace message. It's not a message. It's a person. Here's an interesting thing to consider. One of the words for a word in Hebrew or a command in Hebrew is also translated as a thing in Hebrew, melach. It means a word and it means a thing. So God used the same word in Hebrew to talk about words and things. Because when He speaks a word, same word, the Word became. If I'm going to walk in the faith of Abraham, then I must speak the word in faith and know that it will become. I must know that it will become. If you're speaking, you're walking in the blessing and the covenant of Abraham, and you speak the word in faith concerning, let's say, your sickness, healing, you need to know that it will become a healing. You need to know that it will become prosperity. You need to know that it will become whatever you set it to do, it will become. The word became flesh. Why did that happen? Because for thousands of years, men have been prophesying Him into the world. That's the way He came. He couldn't have just come down here. They had to prophesy Him in. And each one built upon the next one in prophecy. And He became, once the fullness of His prophecy had come, this is why we talk about the rapture. This is why we talk about His second coming. We're prophesying it will become. He will return. We're talking it into existence. Praise God. Man, I'm... If I had an organ in here, we'd have church right now. I'm just saying. Patrick was there. Where'd he go? To God, the Word is the thing. Because when He speaks it, it becomes the thing spoken. You're created like that in Him. The moment you speak the thing, this, it becomes the thing. Oh, man, I'm getting happy. Romans 10. I'm out of time. I got to hurry. Romans 10. But the righteousness which is based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, where? In your mouth and in your heart. You could say in your spirit. That is the word of faith that we preach. What is it that we say? Verse 9. That if you confess, means to say the same thing. That if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. Don't we say that every time?
Yes.
That if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's how easy it is to get saved, sweetheart. That's all you got to do. All that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. All you have to do to be saved is say, I believe that you are the Son of God, that you died on the cross, that you rose from the dead, and you are my Lord. The moment you did that, the blessing came into your life. The blessing is operating in your life. Right then, with the heart, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. You got saved by saying the word, not by doing rules. The word always becomes, it always becomes. Your life in the blessing began when you spoke by faith confessing Jesus. Matter of fact, if you never said that before and you just said that with me just then, if you've never said that before, if you're watching and in the chat room, that chat room will jump all over you like a duck on a June bug in a minute. If you need Jesus, they'll pray for you right then, right there. We're going to mail you some stuff. Get some information. EMIC, what is it? .org info, whatever that is. They'll put it on the screen. Get that. We'll send you some stuff about what just happened to you. Praise God. Because you just, there it is right there. There it is right there. What does it say? Info@emic.org. Info@emic.org. If you just confess him as your Savior, and if you hadn't, do it right now, we'll send you some information free about what just happened to you. You are now part of the family walking in the blessing. In the blessing. The blessing will be your power. The blessing is going to be your power. The blessing now will overtake you. It's designed to do that. It's what it's designed to do. Well, Brother Greg, I've tried that, and I don't understand how that works. There are many things that I don't understand, but it still works. I wasn't asked to understand it. I was asked to believe it. God's word is the seed form of faith. Go to Mark chapter 4. You know this. Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. He said, the kingdom of God is like a man who scatters seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He does not know how. Quit trying to understand how. Lord, mercy. It's like a grain of mustard seed, which is sown into the ground, is the smallest seed on the earth. Yet when it's sown, it grows up and becomes greater than all shrubs and shoots out great branches so that the birds of the air may nest in its shade. Isn't that beautiful? What made the Copelands so successful is this. They both took this book, and they kept an attitude, if the Bible says that it's this way, then that's the way we're going to live. And that's the way we're going to operate our lives. And they've done it. And the blessing has flat out overtaken them. You're worshiping and being taught in a debt-free church. And a debt-free ministry. Because the Lord instructed him concerning some things doing that, and he changed the way. If it says it, that's the way we're going to do it. People are always trying to get their faith increased. The disciples even asked that in Luke 17. One day they said, Lord, increase our faith. And the Lord said, if you had the faith of a grain of mustard seed, you could say to the mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, it would obey you. If you want to live in the blessing, you're going to have to plant the word inside yourself. And then you're going to have to believe it. Not understand it, believe it. I don't understand how that works. I don't care if you understand how that works. Believe it. It will come to pass. Let me tell you this. This is nothing new. This has been from the beginning, and I'm going to start winding this down. I want to show you something that God has always wanted to operate like this in his people. Exodus chapter 17, going back to the First Testament. You guys okay tonight?
Yes.
Doing all right at home? Exodus chapter 17, verse number 1. All the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin. You need to journey from the wilderness of Sin. From place to place, according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore, the people contended with Moses and said, "Give us water so that we may drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you contend with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted for water there. And the people murmured against Moses and said, "Why is it that you've brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" They didn't believe the love. Haven't you heard Brother Copeland talk about that? Then Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, I have done this prayer. I gotta confess to you as a pastor, I've said this one. "What shall I do with this people? They're almost ready to stone me." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Pass over before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the rod which you struck the Nile, and go. Indeed, I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and there water shall come out of it, so that the people may drink." Then Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Strike in the Hebrew means to hammer or to crush. I want you to crush the rock. The rock here in Hebrew is the Hebrew word El Isor. It means God of the rock, or a precious stone, listen to this, or a place of refuge. I want you to crush the precious stone. The place of refuge. Or God of the rock. Now, in Exodus 33, a very interesting thing happens. Exodus 33, Moses asked for something that he had no right to ask for. He asked, "Show me your glory." Remember that? In other words, can I see you? I'd like to see you. Can I look at you? Can you show me you? And what did God say to him? "Excuse me, nobody's ever seen my face and lived. That's not possible." However, because all the promises of God are yes and amen, Moses asked for something not in his time frame. Let me show you this. He said, "Nevertheless, I'm going to place you," read it in Exodus 33. I'm not going to take the time tonight. "I'm placing you in the cleft of the rock. And I will go past you." I'll put my hand there. I'm going to past you, and you'll see my hinder part. You'll see my history. This is how Moses wrote everything. He saw God from that moment all the way back. He saw the history of God. And so he said, "There's a place where you can stand." Go read it sometime. "There's a place where you can stand," I'm paraphrasing, "by me." Question. Who's next to God? There is a place next to God. Who is right next to God? Jesus. What is he also referred to? The rock. He's the stumbling block, the stone, right, that the builders rejected. The chief cornerstone of a house that's fitly joined together. For a brief moment in time, to honor the request of the servant of the Lord, God took Moses and put him in Christ Jesus. In the cleft of the rock, in order to answer the man's request. He took him out of his dispensation and put him in ours. We are now seated with him in heavenly places. We're in that position. He took Moses and put Moses in my position. Just so he could do it for him. Because Jesus has not come yet, right? He hasn't been crucified yet. Moses doesn't have access like that yet. And so he places him in the cleft of the rock. Now look what it says, to hammer or crush. Eliot Sor means the god of the rock, a precious stone, or a place of refuge. You will strike, you will crush the rock, and water will come out of it. It's a symbolic. Everything points to one person in the scripture. You will crush the precious rock of God, Jesus. And water, remember when they pierced his side? There's nothing by accident, people. You will crush Jesus and water will come forth, and I'll feed the thirsty. If any of you thirst. You see in it? He's fulfillment of everything. Man, I love him. Let me just stop for a second. Oh, Jesus, I love you so much. Woo! I love it when you reveal yourself to us. We praise you, magnify you, glorify you. Hallelujah. So he temporarily placed him in our time to grant the request. He positioned him in Christ. And again, in Numbers 20, the people get thirsty and they complain. Let me read it to you. Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly to the door of the tent of meeting, and they fell on their faces, and the glory of the Lord appeared to them. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take the rod and gather the assembly together, you and Aaron, your brother. Now look at this. This is different. This is different. This is not the same thing. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take the rod and gather the assembly together, you and Aaron, your brother, and speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will give its water, and you will bring out to them water from the rock. Think about that a minute. This time he's not to crush or hit the rock. Paul, I read it to you a while ago. Shall we bring Christ down? Shall we bring him up? He only has to be sacrificed once. He only needs to be struck once for living water. Now, you're going to speak to him. Amen. Oh, goodness. Amen. Now you're going to speak to him. This is after the rock has been crushed. Yes. From now on, I don't need for Jesus to be crucified again. Oh. Amen. Now all I have to do is speak to him in faith, and it's going to be done. Now look what happened in verse 9. So Moses took the rod from before the Lord as he commanded him from before the Lord. Where has it been? It's been in the Ark of the Covenant. So he took the rod from before the Lord as he commanded him. Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly before the rock. And he said to them, hear now, you rebels. Wait a minute. I don't remember the Lord telling him any of that. You need to understand something about Moshe, Moses. Dude had a temper. Proving it right here. And if you think about it, he thinks he's delivering Israel when he killed the guy. No, he's in the flesh. He's delivering Israel, but he's doing it the wrong way. Let's go. So Moses took the rod before the Lord, and he commanded him. Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly before the rock, and he said to them, hear now, you rebels, will we bring out water from this rock for you? I don't think the Lord ever told him, you're going to do anything. And Moses lifted up his hand, and he struck the rock twice with his rod, and plenty of water came out. The assembly drank and their livestock. And the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, because you did not believe in me. Hear it? It wasn't that he sinned and missed God and didn't keep a commandment. Because you didn't believe in me. Are we missing our day of visitation? To sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore you will not bring this assembly in the land which I've given them. Notice the phrase, will we bring water? No, hot rod, it's not you. It's him. Honey, you didn't save you, Jesus saved you. You didn't make you righteous, Jesus made you righteous. And the blessing is tied to what he did, honey, not what you do. And you will do the right thing if you'll have him in the right place. Speak to the rock. You don't need to strike him again. Right there was the perfect opportunity to teach them to speak the word and receive. Speak the word and receive. The water will give forth. The Spirit will give forth. If you'll speak the word, the Holy Spirit will give it forth to you. Oh, goodness. The showmanship and his temper cost Moses and that generation. You see it? Do you see it now? Teach them to speak the word and to receive. That's why Jesus takes us in Galatians 3. We read it a while ago. This is why he takes us to the blessing of Abraham, not the blessing of Moses. Moses received how? How did Moses become righteous? By faith, by speaking, by confessing, by faith, he became righteous, not by hitting rocks and yelling at the church. I have to watch the way I represent the master to you. If I misrepresent him as being angry and mean and ticked off and just barely tolerating you guys, that's not who he is. I've got to wonder if you even know him. This is why Jesus takes us to the blessing of Abraham, not to Moses. Now, Paul's words that I read to you earlier make sense. Shall Jesus come down from heaven again? No. Everything has been done for you to walk in the blessing. What I'm trying to teach you is right now, you are walking. Are you born again?
Yes.
You're walking in that blessing. You're walking in that blessing. Now, I've got to start speaking words of faith in that, and do that, and know that the word will become. Let's praise him. Let's thank him for a minute. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Father, we give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to the King. Hallelujah. We give you praise. We give you praise.
Come on, let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for the blessing, the one and only blessing that we'll ever need.
Praise God. The blessing is yours. The blessing is there for you. And there's a good word tonight. If you did not get a copy of the notes, you need to go right back online and download them. Listen, this is great. It's got the scriptures in here. And I really like what Pastor Greg read us with the Jewish morning blessing. You'll want to get that and maybe make that a part of your daily routine as well. Amen. Listen, something just happened recently. We just got back from a trip in Branson, Missouri, there at Keith Moore's church. And I wanted you to just see a real quick, brief update of what really happened there. So take a look.
Does not want torment in you, on you, or anything about you.
It does not matter what your past was like. It does not matter where you grew up. It does not matter your family at all. What really matters is who is in you and who is working in you. There is stuff out there that we need. There's stuff out there that needs to move from the hands of the wicked into the hands of the righteous.
Because my God loves me and gave himself for me in the name of Jesus, I am healed. And I resist everything he bore for me on the cross.
Right now, the fire is hitting your body. You know the cartoons where somebody takes somebody and they shake them upside down and all the loose stuff comes out of their pockets on the cartoons? This is what God's doing. He's got us by the feet and he's got us and he's shaking. So everything that's loose is coming out. He's burning it out and he's shaking it out. Just let it shake and let it burn. Hallelujah.
This is Josh. He's been a soccer player all his life. He played soccer for ORU. He got concussions. He's had nothing but migraines. They said he was headed for dementia. His wife drug him in here today. And he's had to wear sunglasses because the light hurt his eyes. And he just felt a fire go over.
Praise God for the fire.
I'm not supposed to be blind. I'm not supposed to be sick. I'm not supposed to be broke. I'm supposed to be blessed.
I praise God. I'm not supposed to be blind. I'm not supposed to be sick.
Not.
Amen. And part of that is what, Pastor Greg?
Blessing.
Living in the blessing. Good word tonight.
Thank you.
If you had to sum up tonight in one thing, what would it be?
One of the phrases that jumped out at me all week was, the word becomes. Whatever word I say, whatever I read out of here,
right,
it becomes. The blessing causes that when I say it by faith.
Say it by faith.
Yeah, absolutely. The faith of Abraham, that's what Jesus took us back to with our covenant. I'm not in the covenant of Moses. I'm in the covenant of Abraham by what Jesus did. The blessing is at work.
God. You know,
the moment I got saved, it went in me.
That's right. It was already resident. And I think absolutely, that's a point that we all miss. If we're not looking for it, we miss the fact it's already there.
It's there. I don't have to try to get this thing. It's there.
It's tapping into it.
It's there.
I was telling the people before you got back here, Pastor Greg, about your Jewish morning blessing that's in the notes if they didn't get it, to get it and read it. It's great.
Yeah.
It's a good part of the routine. Is that part of your routine?
No. Needs to be.
Needs to
I
be
do fun. Something. I don't quote that exactly, but I
that's
do.
That's a good start.
It's a good start.
Yeah.
And what struck me is that the rooster thing.
Yeah.
And Peter heard that day and realized, wow. That's
wow.
what it is. But what I'm learning is they took it seriously. They took their covenant seriously, and they have blessings for everything.
That's
everything
true.
That happens, there's a blessing that happens. And
they created a blessing consciousness.
When they say shalom is a blessing. It's not hi.
Peace be unto you.
It's and shalom alechem, alechem shalom. Peace be unto you. And it means the way things ought to be.
Yeah.
It's literally nothing missing, nothing broken. It's the way things ought to be. And so even in their greeting and in everything they do is a blessing. And I think the church, I think we've missed that.
Absolutely.
Is acknowledging him before we ask for anything.
And you know, Pastor Greg, one of the ways that you can get into this blessing and understanding, and you said it, is getting into the Word. And one of the great ways of getting into the Word is actually what we've talked about, and Brother Copeland's talked about, is total immersion.
Total immersion.
Getting away, spending some time away and getting total immersion.
That's right.
So if you want to know more about maybe some upcoming, maybe you miss Branson and you're thinking, man, I wish I'd have seen that, or wish I'd have been able to go. It's not too late. There's more events. In fact, I want you to watch this and see the next upcoming events that Brother Copeland's going to be at. Watch this.
Come to a Kenneth Copeland Ministries event.
Rejoice and shout out loud. The best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. For God is good. And his mercy endures forever. God is good.
May 26th through 27th, Kenneth Copeland invites you to the Peru Victory Campaign at Eduardo Dibos Coliseum in Lima, Peru. June 15th through 17th, join the Copelands at the Dayton Victory Campaign at the Dayton Convention Center in Dayton, Ohio. June 29th through July 1st, Kenneth and Gloria Copeland welcome you to the Toronto Victory Campaign at Atwell Center in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. July 31st through August 5th, join Kenneth and Gloria Copeland and their special guests for the Southwest Believers Convention in Fort Worth, Texas. For more information, go to kcm.org/events.
Praise God. Those are good events. But listen, there's one that's not on it that's happening right here, Pastor Greg.
You want to be at this church. You want to be at this
4 days of total immersion in the Word starting June 22nd, I believe. It's Billy Burke is going to be right here. And you go, well, Billy Burke's been there before. What's different? What's different about this, which I really like, it's going back to the way it used to be in the days of Oral Roberts and A.A. Allen and R.W. Schambach and these guys, where there was teaching in the morning, healing in the evening. And, you know, there may be some healing in the morning, too.
Yeah, sure.
Some of these,
sure.
But you're going to get word teaching during the day, and then we're going to cap it off Sunday morning right here at Eagle Mountain.
It creates an atmosphere for the miraculous, for healing. You know, in working around healing school all those years ago with Brother Hagin, sometimes it was horrible because people would come, and they're on their deathbed.
Right.
But they've spent 40 years of neglect in the Word, and you're trying to hurry and get as much Word in them, because faith comes by hearing,
right,
as much Word in them so that they're in a position to receive that miracle or that healing. They need a miracle now to heal.
You bring up a really good point that we kind of gloss over a lot. Just because you're not sick doesn't mean you shouldn't come.
Oh, goodness, no.
That is the time to come.
That's the time to come.
In you.
That's the absolute time
All right,
to come.
So Greg, this is your, explain what these pictures are.
These are e-members. These are partners right here that have sent in their photos. They're part of our people that we pray for, and there's hundreds of them now from all over the world. EMIC.org/photo is how you get
and
your
you
picture
upload,
on here.
Upload your picture.
Upload your picture, fill out the little thing in there, and that's how you get on the board. And don't you love these people?
Yeah, there's some great photos.
They're all out there. That's you.
We love to hear from you. In the picture, we like seeing you and being a part. Pastor Greg, 20 seconds, say a quick prayer.
Father, we thank you for your word. I thank you for these partners. I ask you to bless them as you said so in your word. May the blessing of Abraham, the blessing of Jesus bestowed upon them when they got saved be evident in their life this week. The blessing of God overtake you.
Yes.
In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Well, Amen. Pastor Greg, let's remember, God loves you. Pastor George and Terry love you.
And we love you.
We love you.
Jesus is Lord.